In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. Good morning, everyone. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. Alleluia, alleluia. That's the way. It's the alleluia season of Easter, a season of resurrection, a season of new life. At the 9 o'clock Mass this morning, there was new life. We baptized two little ones, two new Christians into our community. New life. And today we celebrate that new life that Jesus brought to us in this Eucharist. And so let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries.
Lord Jesus, you raise us to new life. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you forgive us our sins. Christ, have mercy.
Almighty God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill.
Glory to God in the highest.
Let us pray. May your people exult forever, O God, in renewed youthfulness of spirit, so that rejoicing now in the restored glory of our adoption, we may look forward in confident hope to the rejoicing of the day of resurrection. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter said to the people, "The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and denied in Pilate's presence when he had decided to release him. You denied the Holy and Righteous One and asked that a murderer be released to you. The author of life you put to death. But God raised him from the dead. Of this we are witnesses. Now I know, brothers, that you acted out of ignorance, just as your leaders did. But God has thus brought to fulfillment what he had announced beforehand through the mouth of all the prophets, that his Christ would suffer. Repent, therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be wiped away." The word of the Lord.
A reading from the first letter of St. John. My children, I am writing this to you so that you might not commit sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is expiation for our sins, and not for our sins only, but for those of the whole world. The way we may be sure that we know him is to keep his commandments. Those who say, I know him, but do not keep his commandments are liars, and the truth is not in them. But whoever keeps his word, the love of God is truly perfected in him. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. The two disciples recounted what had taken place on the way and how Jesus was made known to them in the breaking of bread. While they were still speaking about this, he stood in their midst and said to them, "Peace be with you." But they were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. Then he said to them, "Why are you troubled? And why do questions arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Touch me and see. Because a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you can see I have." And as he said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While they were still incredulous for joy and were amazed, he asked them, "Have you anything to eat here?" They gave him a piece of baked fish. He took it and ate it in front of them. He said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and in the prophets and Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Christ would suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance for the forgiveness of sins would be preached in his name to all the nations, beginning from Jerusalem. you are witnesses of these things. The Gospel of the Lord. What defines being a Christian? Some would say that to be a Christian is to put your mind, your intellect, around a certain list of propositions or truths. And those truths would include, perhaps, that Jesus Christ is both Son of Mary and Son of God, that he lived a perfect life, spoke as no person ever spoke, died on the cross, was buried, and rose from the dead. But others might give a little different answer. Others might say, yes, but to be a Christian also requires us to live by a certain ethic. Christians live by the golden rule. But does all of that really make you a Christian? And so we can ask the question again, what is it that defines your life as being Christian? These answers and others certainly are worthy, but are they adequate? I wonder how the writers of the New Testament would answer our question. So let's perhaps ask them. Ask Mark, the gospel writer. Ask Dr. Luke. Ask John, the beloved disciple. Ask the Apostle Peter. What does being a Christian mean for you? Today's scripture passages, I think, offer an answer to our question from across the centuries. The witness of the New Testament suggests to us that the defining hallmark of being a Christian is to live radically transformed by the Easter message. The apostles and the church through the ages would say with us, yes, I have put my intellect, my mind, around a select group of truths about a person, Jesus of Nazareth. And we know all that he did. And yes, I also live by the ethic Jesus taught. Yeah, I do all of that. Now, all three of the passages heard today help us to answer our question. As we did last week, we hear again the writer of the brief little letter of 1 John. This early Christian felt compelled, even obligated, to say, if you are a Christian, the resurrection of Jesus Christ has not only changed history, but it carries with it profound personal responsibilities. And one of those responsibilities is to say a good word, even good news about God. God is light, and in him there is no darkness. The verses we heard from the Acts of the Apostles are part of a sermon preached by St. Peter. And his sermon reminds us that the preaching of the early church was clearly focused on God and His love. Those first believers communicated good news about God. God was neither a tyrant who needed to be appeased, nor was He a doting parent who demanded obedience. Unlike the fickle and frightening deities of the Romans, God invites us into a relationship of love. And yet, how many people live, bow down under what they believe is the frown or an angry God? As Luke reported in our reading, our Lord calls us to be witnesses of God's work, to tell the story of this one who loves us, one who will never let us go, one who is always there for us. One of the defining aspects of being Christian is to tell this life-changing story of Jesus and His love. To tell the story and not be afraid to do so. To tell the story also by our actions and how we live. Our three texts are telling us that in Christ, God is actually rather busy creating a new humanity for a new community. Everything about God, as seen through the prism, the lens of Jesus, tells us that God is making all things new. Remember, Easter is about new life. And if we walk in the light, as Jesus Himself is the light, then we have a relationship with one another. And we have a relationship with Jesus. The defining hallmark of being Christian is the gift of living in fellowship with others. With Jesus, yes, but also with the forgiven, the gifted, those loved by God. So what is God saying to us through today's scriptures? These scriptures in the Easter season. For one thing, we have nothing to fear in God. The very angels who said to the women at the empty tomb, "Fear not," are among us today saying the same thing. God is present to us into a new relationship with God. God's invitation is extended with nail-scarred hands through the person of Jesus. Whatever pictures of God we carry around that are not created by pixels of love need to be thrown away. By the same token, God is asking us to accept our responsibility to live the Christian faith that we profess. Surely we will profess that faith with some questions and answers and water sprinkled. But it is that Christian faith that is lived out and experienced by us that is so important. That Christ died for our sins, was buried, and raised on the third day is life-changing good news. Because the Lord lives, we live now and evermore. What defines being a Christian? Is it merely memorized words or regimented rituals or even remembered stories? Those acts may inform our Christian experience, but not necessarily define it. To be a Christian is to champion the radical picture of God made living and life-changing through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. To be a Christian is to define our lives by a grace none of us deserve and none of us can earn. To be a Christian is to live joyfully in this new humanity God is creating for us called church. On this Lord's Day, God gives us the invitation to move beyond the words of Easter to the experience of our Christian Easter faith, to make that life-affirming move when with joy we receive and give Easter gifts. So join with me today, join with all who believe this glorious good news that Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. Because not just Easter Sunday, but each day of this Easter season, we know that we celebrate Easter again. We know that this risen Jesus is here with us today, right here in our midst, right there next to you, right behind you, in front of you. Jesus is here. But he doesn't just remain here. He's right with you as you leave this Mass, down the steps, going towards Connecticut or 17th Street, wherever you might be going, he's there with you. But not only is he simply there, because he is part of you. You are part of him. When you receive the Eucharist, that happens. He becomes a part of you and you become a part of him, because then you are his presence. When you go forth, others should be able to see you in your smile, in your word of welcome, whatever it might be. Others should be able to see Jesus in you, in what you say, in what you do. Because that is that new life that we are sharing, given to us by Jesus in his resurrection. And that's why we can say every day, this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. Alleluia, alleluia. You kind of, everybody waited for somebody else to say alleluia, it seemed, you know. See, it hasn't become a part of you yet, right? So this is the day of the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. And now, my dear brothers and sisters, through the Paschal mystery, we have been buried with Christ in baptism, so that we may walk with him in newness of life. And so let us renew the promises of holy baptism, by which we renounced Satan and his works, and promised to serve God in the Holy Catholic Church. And so I ask you, do you renounce sin so as to live in the freedom of the children of God? Do you renounce the lure of evil so that sin may have no mastery over you? Do you renounce Satan, the author and prince of sin? Do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth? Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was born of the Virgin Mary, suffered death and was buried, rose again from the dead, and is seated at the right hand of the Father? Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting? And may Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us new birth by water and the Holy Spirit, and bestowed on us forgiveness of our sins, keep us by his grace in Christ Jesus, our Lord, for eternal life. Amen.
Springs of water, bless the Lord. Springs of water, bless the Lord. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
And now I would ask you to be seated, but I would ask all of the engaged couples who are here today to please come forward. Don't be afraid of one another, you know. Okay, I don't want no two rows. Come around a little bit. That's it. Okay. What do you think? Not bad, huh? These are at least some of our engaged couples. Grateful for those who could make it today and be here, because it is an exciting day. Like I said, at the 9 o'clock, baptize two new Christians. We're here at St. Matthew's. And now here you are, because you too, you may not be baptized again, or ever, you know, whatever. But the point is that you are here to share what I was talking about, that love of Jesus, the love of God that he has given to you to share now in a very special way with each other. And to know that he is always here with you. And that's pretty special. And all of you have, you know, you've come forward and said, we want to do that. Because you put in a lot of time. Preparation for marriage isn't just, hi, Father, you ready? Let's do it. Not quite, is it? But it's wonderful to have you here today. And also because you are a sign to others out there. There may be some other couples out there thinking about, oh, maybe we should get engaged or something, you know. Okay, you're saying, go for it, right? Okay. We're just glad to have you here as part of our family here at St. Matthew's. I need a lector. Okay, the petitions for this particular Mass. Okay. So now let's stand. We know that all of us need God's blessing at all times, but at the time of their engagement to be married, couples are in particular need of grace as they prepare themselves to form a new and special union. Let us pray then for God's blessing to come upon these couples, that as they await the day of their wedding, they will grow in mutual respect and in their love for one another, that through their companionship and prayer together, they will prepare themselves for marriage.
The church and its leaders in their efforts to bring about peace and reconciliation between nations and peoples, and for their efforts to promote dialogue between those of different faith traditions. For Pope Francis, Archbishop Gregory, and all those who serve this local church, that they may grow in wisdom and serve with generous hearts.
Let us pray to the Lord.
For a renewed determination to bring about a more just and peaceful society. For all those who are seeking effective solutions to gun violence and hurtful discrimination of any kind. For peace in the Middle East and for the end of war in Ukraine.
Let us pray to the Lord.
For refugees and migrants fleeing war, gang violence and oppression. For those who are most vulnerable to the effects of the climate crisis and the extreme weather it causes. And for all those who are taking steps to alleviate the suffering caused by these conditions.
Let us pray to the Lord.
That these engaged couples present here today and all other engaged couples of our community will experience an increase in mutual love as they prepare for the sacrament of marriage.
Let us pray to the Lord.
That this community and the parents of our engaged couples will pray for and support all our engaged couples in their journey leading to the sacramental bond. Let us pray to the Lord.
Let us pray to the Lord.
For the sick who have asked for our prayers, and for all who suffer from chronic illness or terminal disease, for those struggling with substance abuse and addictions and mental illness, and for all those who come to the aid of the sick.
Let us pray to the Lord.
For all who have recently died with the hope of rising again with Christ, that they may be washed clean in the blood of the Lamb and be welcomed into the kingdom of heaven, and for their families and friends who grieve their loss.
Let us pray to the Lord.
And now, as we bless the couples that are here with us today, I would ask all of you to join us, to join me as we bless them, because it is our community that is really blessing them and calling the Lord's blessing upon them. So I would ask you to extend your hands in blessing. Lord God, the source of all love, the wise plan of your providence has brought these young people together. As they prepare themselves for the sacrament of marriage and pray for your grace, grant that strengthened by your blessing, they may grow in their respect for one another and cherish each other with a sincere love. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And my friends, I ask you now to join and to congratulate, bless, and also to let them know that we're for them 100%. And just a reminder, you can be seated. Just a reminder that the mission of our cathedral parish depends on your continuing support. We appreciate those who give regularly through Faith Direct or your weekly envelopes, as well as those who contribute now as we pass the basket or by using the QR code in your music programs. And we thank you for your generosity. pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Receive, O Lord, we pray, these offerings of your exultant church, and as you have given her cause for such great gladness, grant also that the gifts we bring may bear fruit in perpetual happiness, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time above all, to laud you yet more gloriously when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. He never ceases to offer himself for us, but defends us and ever pleads our cause before you. He is the sacrificial victim who dies no more, the lamb once slain who lives forever. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exalts in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Wilton, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we now dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope in the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. And let us offer each other the sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord,
thank you. Let us pray. Look with kindness upon your people, O Lord, and grant, we pray, that those you were pleased to renew by eternal mysteries may attain in their flesh the incorruptible glory of the resurrection. Through Christ our Lord. And just a couple of announcements. Join in a series of classes on St. Paul's letter to the Romans. That would be on Tuesday evenings, April 16th, 23rd, 30th, and May 7th, from 7 to 8:30 p.m. in the East Conference Room. And come and experience the liberating grace of Christ. Now we have a special announcement.
Good morning, everyone. You may have noticed on the way in, there's a big banner out front, as well as posters at all the entrances. Next Sunday afternoon at 3:30 p.m., we're having a very special service of 9 lessons and carols, including poems and reflections and scripture and excellent music, all helping us to focus our attention on both the beauty and the fragility of the natural world that God has given us so generously to share in. The Schola Cantorum and the Cathedral lectors, including some very young lectors as well, will be joining us to reflect on these themes. It's a very worthwhile afternoon for the parish family. We hope you can bring some friends too. Last year it was extremely well received, but it was in the evening. We thought doing it this year in the afternoon might make it easier for people to attend. So it's 3:30 in the afternoon. The parking garage will be open. Please join us next week for a really splendid afternoon. It's shorter than last year, and it's some new music. If you were here last year, you'll hear some new pieces. But it'll be encouraging, too, for what we can all do to reflect on our future together. Thanks very much.
And I'll be here, so I hope you'll be here as well and be glad to see you again next week. So the Lord be with you. And let us now bow down for the blessing. And this is another opportunity that you have for a nice, strong amen after each part of the solemn blessing. I'll give you a clue each time so you'll get it. May God, who by the resurrection of his only begotten Son, was pleased to confer on you the gift of redemption and of adoption, give you gladness by his blessing. May he by whose redeeming work you have received the gift of everlasting freedom make you heirs to an eternal inheritance. Amen. And may you who have already risen with Christ in baptism through faith, by living in a right manner on this earth, be united with him in the homeland of heaven. Amen. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.
Please join in singing our recessional hymn, That Easter Day with Joy Was Bright, in your red worship hymnals number 514.
Easter Day with joy was bright, the song. Yeah, I got it. Oop, it's on. The thing's on.